Good morning, Bedford View Methodist Church family. Once again, welcome to our third Sunday of the Easter season. Friends, I hope you are enjoying these online services and they help you to grow spiritually as people of God and help you to understand the Word of God better. I know it's difficult times because not all of us can come to church, but I commit in continuing to connect with you online. Let us then begin with a call to worship. Our call to worship this morning is Psalm 4, verses 1 to 5. Psalm 4, verses 1 to 5, a psalm of David. Answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayers. How long will you people turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods? Know that the Lord has set apart his faithful servant for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. Tremble and do not sin when you are on your beds, search your hearts and be silent. Offer the sacrifice of righteousness and truth in the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, let us then light the peace candle. As I light this peace candle this morning, to remind each of every one of us and those who are watching that Christ is the light of the world, that no darkness shall overcome him. He proved that in 40 days when he was in the wilderness and he was tempted, yet he did not sin. So this light is a reminder of that power that Jesus has. And is a reminder that our own light may shine into the darkness of the world through encounters with friends and families. So Christ, may your light shine into this world and in our lives and into this service. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, enjoy the opening song.
To the river I am going, bringing sins I cannot bear. Come and cleanse me, come forgive me, Lord, I need to meet you there. Precious Jesus, I am ready to surrender every care. Take my hand now, lead me closer, Lord, I need to meet you there. In these waters, healing mercy flows with freedom from despair. I am going to that river, Lord, I need to meet you there. Precious Jesus, I am ready to surrender every care. Take my hand now, lead me closer, Lord, I need to meet you there. Come and join us in the river. Come find life beyond compare. He is calling, he is waiting. Jesus longs to meet us all there. Precious Jesus, I am ready. lead me closer. Lord, I need to meet you there.
Amen. Let us pray. Father, I come before your throne of grace this morning, O Lord, asking for your spirit to guide and lead this service. Be with me as I lead your people, O Lord. I'm a mere human being full of faults and mistakes. I'm not perfect, but I know if I'm led and surrounded by the presence of the Holy Spirit, I will do what is pleasing to you, O God, and I will do your will. So bless me. Bless those who are watching the service, O Lord. Be with them. May their hearts and minds be focused on this time of worship, 35, 40 minutes of worship, God, that when it's finished, they may feel fulfilled and refreshed. And they may feel they are ready to go out to the world and spread the good news. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Father, I pray for the church throughout the world, the entire church, universal church. That will be with the church members and the church leaders. That they may know and understand, O God, what it means to be a child of God, what it means to be an ambassador of Christ, and what it means to be a born-again Christian. May we then, as church members throughout the world, including members of this church, Bedford View Methodist Church, live the gospel in our actions and in our words. May people, when encounter members of this church and other churches, God, say, I want to be like them because they live a righteous life. Help us then, God, because without you, we cannot do anything. We can't be righteous unless we encounter you, O Father. So help church leaders, ministers, pastors, priests, bishops, presiding bishops, all of them, God, lay leaders, lay pastors, youth pastors, children pastors. When they lead your people, God, may they be guided by the presence of your Holy Spirit. So that whatever they do, whatever we do it in the name of God. Same as the church members. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Father, I pray for all the leaders of the world, the presidents, ministers, prime ministers, and all different leaders, that they may be guided by your spirit in their decision making. That in whatever they do or say to your people, they may be led by you, O God. And the only way they can do that is if they seek you first, God, and everything will be granted unto them. May they have a heart that seeks you, God, a heart that understands you. Because when they do, they will leave people with integrity, justice, and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Father, I pray for all the families throughout the world. During these difficult times of COVID-19, we hear of many families that have lost their loved ones, that they are still grieving the loss. Some blaming different governments for not taking action. Some blaming the medical field. But I pray, God, that they may find peace and comfort in you, in knowing that you are not punishing them, knowing that you love them and care for them, that in this pandemic, God, that we are facing, you are with us every step of the way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Father, I pray, knowing that we are sinners saved by grace, and I come to confess our sins as your people, the ones we know we do deliberately, the ones we don't know, that you forgive us of our sins, and we may find joy in knowing that you are a God that forgives and a God that loves. So forgive us, Father, of everything, and grant us newness of life, so that when we face life, we may face it afresh. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. So, Father, I thank you for this time and opportunity to be able to share the gospel with your people. Bless your people. Bless this church. Bless the leaders of this church. Bless each and every person that comes and worship in this church and gives to this church and the ministry of this church. I pray all these things in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, our reading for this morning is Luke chapter 24, reading from verse 36 to verse 49. Our reading from this morning, Luke chapter 24, verse 36 to verse 49. And once again, my wife Nandi will be reading the scripture for us. Enjoy the scripture of God.
Jesus appears to the disciples. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I, myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. Let us pray. Father, I pray that you open our hearts and our minds as we explore your word this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Friends, as you are aware, I explained last week that we are in a season of Easter, or Easter season. As you know, it's the 50 days after Jesus was resurrected from the dead, which then will end on Pentecost Sunday when the Holy Spirit comes on God's people. That's when we end the Easter season, those 50 days. So today, as we gather, is the third Sunday of Easter then. And today we encounter Jesus encountering or meeting two of his disciples on the road to Emmaus. But today I'm not going to focus on the story on the road to Emmaus. But this is what this chapter is about. Jesus meeting these men, or these men encountering Jesus on the road to Emmaus. Hence, then, my theme for this morning is Jesus opening our minds to understand God's words, God's word. I will explain to you what I mean by that. Because as they were on this road to Emmaus, and then Jesus encountered them, and there were things that were said between them and Jesus. Because remember, they thought he was a ghost. They did not believe that it was Jesus until he had to reveal scriptures to them so that their minds were open. How did he do that? There are many ways that Jesus does this to God's people. But for the sake of this chapter, I'm just going to highlight four things that Jesus did to open their minds to understand the word of God. And these are helpful ways to understand the word of God according to Luke chapter 24, verse 36 to verse 49. So these are not like the rules that I'm going to say. This is how you understand the word of God. There are many ways you understand the word of God. There are many things you can do to understand the word of God. But here, I'm going to highlight four things that Jesus did to help these men open their minds in understanding the word of God. First, to understand the word of God, you need to encounter Jesus. What do I mean by that? Excuse me. Luke 24, verse 36. While they were still talking about this, so they were talking about what happened in Jerusalem, what happened about the crucifixion of Jesus. So they were sharing the story of Easter. So that's what these men were doing. They were sharing to each other the story of Easter. So that's why it says, while they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." I'm not going to go through the peace part because last week I explained what means when Jesus says, "Peace be with you." But what I want to talk about is Jesus appearing to these men, Because the Bible says here, they were talking, and then Jesus stood among them. So they were not expecting him. They did not know it was him. They were even scared. But for them then to understand the scriptures, for them to understand the story of the resurrection, for them to understand the story of their salvation, what they needed was an encounter with Jesus. Friends, you can never understand the good news. You can never understand the good news of the cross, the story of the cross, the meaning of the cross, the meaning of resurrection, unless you encounter Jesus. Yes, all those are written here in the scriptures. All those. You see, one of the reasons people struggle to understand the Bible, it is because when we read the Bible, we do like when we read the magazine or tabloids or whatever news we read, newspapers, if people still read those. We read them like that. But this word, for you to understand this word, you need to have an encounter with Jesus, like these men did. Because before that, they did not know the story of Easter. For you to understand, now that we are in the season of Easter, how then do you understand, you get to understand the story of the season of Easter is to have an encounter with Jesus. Encounter with the author of these words. Because remember, the book of Timothy is clear. The book of Timothy is clear that people that wrote these words, people that wrote the Bible, they were inspired by God. It's like the prophets. When they will prophesy what would happen, God will speak to them, and then they will go to the people and say, "Thus says the Lord." Why? Because the prophets have encountered Jesus. What happened to Moses? Moses, for him to go to Pharaoh, to plead with him, to release the Israelites, what happened? The burning bush story. The burning bush experience. That's Moses encountering Jesus. Paul. Paul, we know who he was before he became Paul. We know what he used to do. We know what he used to do to Christians. He persecuted them. But what happened? He had to encounter Jesus for him to change and understand the word of God. That's what I'm talking about here, friends. That's what I'm talking about here. John, what had to do? Before coming and telling people to repent, he had to go to the wilderness and encounter God, eat honey and locust, and then come back to the people and say, prepare the way, repent. So that's what I'm talking about. For us to understand, for the word of God to be meaningful, for the word of God to make sense to us, we need to encounter Jesus just like these men did. It is only after they encountered Jesus they understood what the word of God meant about the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Maybe the reason you're struggling with your faith, I'm suggesting, maybe there are many, but one of the reasons you're struggling with your faith is that you haven't had an encounter with Jesus yet. Friends, spirituality, Christianity, it's not only about here, you know, your intellect, your brains, your mind. No, it's about your heart. These need to talk to one another. And encountering Jesus then are those testimonies that you give to people, and then those testimonies, they show that what is said in the word is truth. So therefore, my question for you this morning, have you encountered Jesus? If not, friends, you need to start growing spiritually, encountering Jesus. What do? You open your heart to God. You give your life to Christ. That's what you do. Let me turn it so that I can read straight from the Bible. It's the book of Romans. I think it's Romans 10:9 or 9:10. Simple. Let's see. 10:9. So that would be 10, verse 9. It says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, Romans 10, verse 9. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Boom. That's your encounter with Jesus. Simple as that. Simple. You see how simple it is? So it's simple. It's about declaring with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, believing in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and you are saved. Then in other words, you give your life to Christ, you are saved, and then Christ lives in your heart, and then you know that you've encountered him. Then when you read the word of God, it means you'll be inspired by the Spirit to understand what is written here. Secondly, how did he help them? open their minds to God's word. He had fellowship with them. Friends, you need to fellowship with one another. The fellowship I'm talking about is the breaking of bread. Listen to this. And while they still did not believe it, that was Jesus, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. That eating is not that amazing. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think Jesus was hungry. Jesus is God. He stayed for 40 days without eating, without drinking. It's not that Jesus was hungry. But it's the significance in the Jewish culture of sharing bread, of eating with each other, is fellowship. So therefore, for them to understand the word of God, they had spent time in fellowship with Jesus, with one another, sharing bread, eating together. That is why it is important, friends, as Christians, as members of Bedford View, as God's people, to be a member of a fellowship group or Bible study or home group or cell group or class group, whatever you call it. Because it's called different names. Here we call it fellowship groups. Some call it a class meeting, which is original Methodist name from John Wesley's time. Some call it a cell group. Some call it a home group. So you may have different names, it's fine. But what is important is that once a week, you fellowship with one another. If you want to go every day, I won't stop you. But what I'm saying to you, as your shepherd, as your minister, it is important for God's people, once a week, you meet with others to fellowship, to break bread, to share the word of God, to read the scriptures, to teach one another the scriptures, to understand what the scriptures say. Because Sunday cannot be enough. It cannot be enough that you come and listen to me on a Sunday. And what is lovely now during the time of COVID is that we've started things like the online Bible studies. Zoom Bible studies. Excuse me. WhatsApp Bible studies. Whichever way works for you, there are many ways and things that you can be part of online to make sure that you grow spiritually. It was important for Jesus because he knew that these men were Jewish, so they understood breaking bread, what it means. Breaking bread is time for fellowship, not just eating. So therefore, when you are part of a fellowship group, then we are part of that family where you share the word of God with one another, where you teach each other, where you ask questions, where you grow spiritually. And you take it further. You fellowship, you have coffee and tea. That's what is good about this. And then that helps you. It opens your mind to the word of God because that's a relaxed and free environment. And no one will judge you there when you don't have an answer because we don't have answers for everything. So friends, fellowship groups are very important in opening your mind, in understanding the word of God. That's why Jesus would go and break bread with his disciples and talk to them. That's why Jesus would visit homes. Remember the sisters of Lazarus, he would visit homes and have meal. That was fellowship. It was not him going there to eat. No, that was fellowship. Eating was part of it, but the most important thing was the conversation and the conversations that took place. That's what fellowship, that's what breaking bread is all about. Thirdly, he opened their minds to understand the word of God by reminding them that the New Testament is the fulfillment of the Old Testament. Listen to what it says. Luke 24, verse 44. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses and prophets and Psalms." Excuse me. It breaks my heart. I'm not going to mention names. When I hear some churches saying we should do away with Old Testament, it's outdated. It's not important. Or people thinking, I don't need to read the Old Testament. It doesn't even make sense. There are killings there and everything. So I don't understand what's happening there. I'll stick to the New Testament. Friends, let me tell you, Jesus was clear to them. He said, "I told you whilst I was with you that everything must be fulfilled that is written in the law of Moses, the first five books, in the prophets, and in the Psalms. Those things must be fulfilled." So what is written then, friends, when you look, when you open your Bible in the content, is it content? You will see the book of the Old Testament. There are many, 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 many books there. Those were not a waste of time. There are words that are said there that are only fulfilled. You'll only understand them. So firstly, what I'm saying to you is, for you to read the Old Testament, you might be confused and not sure what's happening. But there are things that you read there. When you go to the New Testament, you're like, oh, I read about this. You know, this is fulfilled. Typical example, the story of Palm Sunday. Remember, Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Preached about how Jesus was going to enter Jerusalem. So by virtue of reading the Old Testament, you'll know, oh yes, the reason he came on a donkey, not a horse or a fancy car or two-door car or open roof or open top car, was because Zechariah said, this is how the Son of God will enter Jerusalem. So therefore then, when it happens in the Gospels, because the Gospels, they all write about it. When it happens in the Gospels, you already know, oh, this was spoken about. So that's why it is important then. When you want to open your mind to the Word of God, to understand the Old Testament, because the Old Testament is fulfilled in the New Testament, then when you encounter those, you know already. So those prophets did not waste their time by saying those things. The book of Psalm, David did not waste his time by writing those. Moses did not waste his time by writing those five books. He knew that what is written, because they were told and inspired by God to write and say those things, will be fulfilled by Jesus himself in the New Testament. And that's what will open your mind to the Word of God, if you understand those things. And lastly, for your mind to be open to the Word of God, you need to be filled by the Holy Spirit. Listen to what Jesus says in the last verse. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, that is the Holy Spirit. But stay in the city until you have been clothed with the power from on high. So, right? Now for them to understand, that's what I said, I think, from the first point. You need to be inspired, you need to be full of the Spirit to understand. Because there are things, yes, when you read them from the Old Testament, you're thinking, ooh, these battles, these people killed by this man, these people, they want to war, this and that. You think, no, God can't do that. But you need to be inspired by the Spirit to understand those things. And only then you can know, you know what, okay, this is why this happened. Yes, God is a God of love, but also he's a just God. So I need to understand those characters of God to understand the Bible. And the Spirit will come into you and help you and reveal those things to you so that you understand why these things had to happen. Because Jesus Christ didn't come to change things, but to fulfill. He came to fulfill the Word of God. He's the fulfillment of what was said. So, but for you to understand such deepness, such depth, you need to be filled by the Spirit. And also, because remember, not only that, so the last point, it shows that now the Spirit filled them to understand the Word of God, but also they were told to wait until they are filled by the Spirit, so that when they go, then spread the good news. Because remember, once you understand the Word of God, you don't sit at home and fold your arms. No, you go out there and preach the Word. How? In action and in words. So he knew that they can't face the world. Because Jesus is clear that amongst the people around here in the world, in the church or anywhere you go, there are wolves wrapped in a sheep's clothing. So he knew that they needed to be prepared for that, so that when they face them, they know that, you know what, we don't come empty, we don't come alone, but we come with the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will give you power not to fear anything or anyone, but say what is right. And as you know, in history will tell you, some of the disciples were murdered. Why? Because of the Word of God. But because they were filled by the Spirit, they were not scared. They went and shared the good news. Even if it meant they lost their own lives. Because why? They were filled by the Spirit. So therefore, friends, you need to remember that. For your mind to be open to the Word of God, you encounter Jesus. You fellowship with one another. You understand that the New Testament is the fulfillment of the Old Testament. And also, you need to be filled by the Spirit of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Sorry, let us pray. Father, I give you thanks and praise, Lord Jesus, for your word. I pray that this morning you bless each and every person that has heard this word. And that from now on, as your people, will spend our time daily on the scripture to understand your word, so that you open our minds to your word. Help us to encounter you, God, at all times. Fill us with your Spirit. Bless us all. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, enjoy the closing song. Amen.
lift my hands to the coming King, to the great I am, to you I sing, for you're the one who reigns within my heart, and I will serve no foreign God or any other treasure, for you are my heart's desire, the Spirit without measure. Unto your name I will bring my sacrifice. I lift my hands to the coming King, to the great I am, to you I sing, for you're the one who reigns within my heart, and I will serve no foreign God or any other treasure. For you are my heart's desire,
only you, Lord,
the Spirit without measure. Unto your name I will bring my sacrifice. Unto your name I will bring my sacrifice.
Amen. So before I pronounce the benediction, I'm sure you've heard on the BMC news about the 2nd of May, which is our Thanksgiving service as Bedford U. I sat with the leaders of BMC and we felt it was the right time to give thanks to God. I mean, we've been through a lot, friends. I mean, with COVID-19, we've been through a lot. And I know that, you know, some of us have lost our loved ones and we're still hurting. But we need to give thanks to God. Thus far, He has been with us. So 2nd of May, in all our services here at Bedford View, 9:30, 11 o'clock, 6 o'clock, we'll be giving thanks to God. A thanksgiving service to God, and also the online service will be a service of thanksgiving to God. So I hope you know that and you keep that, so that when that, I know it's still a bit far, but I thought I should share it with you, the importance of it and why we're doing it. So thank you, friends. May God bless you. Please stand as we pronounce the benediction. Please raise your hands with me. Let's say it together. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace, in Jesus' name. Have a blessed week. Amen.